Real joins Sancho Chase, Bellerin is on PSG's radar, the Premier League is set for a big meeting, a transfer roundup, and today's Thursday favourites all coming up in the next few minutes, as I'm your host, Matt Froelich. You are the One Footballers, and this is the Daily News. So, first up, and actually, before we get into the story, thanks so much for 400,000 subscribers. That is awesome. Now we start on the road to 500k. But anyway, talking of 500k, that's probably how much Jadon Sancho would make per week if he were to move to Real Madrid. They are the latest club interested in the Englishman, amongst others like Liverpool, Chelsea and Manchester United, and it kind of fits Real Madrid's strategy at the moment. They're not going through a complete turnaround, but they are getting rid of a few older faces and bringing in some younger players for the next generation. Sancho fits the bill. I just don't quite think the Real Madrid are going to shell out that kind of money. I mean, first off, it looks like they're saving money for Mbappe, which they definitely should. Sancho's great, Mbappe's better. Secondly, they've got quite a few Brazilian youngsters in the same position as Sancho at the moment. I don't think they're proving themselves to be better than him, but it's only because he's playing regular first-team football at Dortmund. If the likes of Vinicius Junior, Rodrigo and Renier as well also managed to get enough first-team football, you'd probably find they're pretty decent players as well. After all, Real Madrid don't pay 30-odd million for 18-year-olds if they're not actually anything special. Well, maybe they've done it before. But besides that, the last point is that Englishmen just don't really do well at Real Madrid. Aside from David Beckham, there's Jonathan Woodgate. The less said about his Real Madrid career, the better. Stephen Mandelman, yeah, he was actually kind of okay. Michael Owen didn't have the best season and then moved back to England. I'm not so sure it's necessarily the greatest move. And talking of British players, yeah, Gareth Bale. Had a good time early on, but definitely is hated. If they bring in another British guy, Sancho's definitely going to have his back up against the wall. Anyway, back to the fact that it's going to be a different, let's say, transfer market. I'm not so sure they're going to be paying over 150 million for anyone, never mind someone who might not be top of their list. And next up, according to reports in France, PSG are looking at Hector Bellerin as a potential replacement for Thomas Meunier. Now, this one seems rather odd to me. Don't get me wrong, Meunier is leaving the club because his contract is expiring. Looks like he could be heading to the Premier League. And yes, PSG want a good right back, and the Hector Bellerin is a good right back. But from Arsenal's point of view, I don't know why they'd sell him. Like, he's 25 years old. He's still got his best years ahead of him if they can keep him injury free. The price that's been quoted is around 30 million euros. A starting right back in the top six in the Premier League going to a rival in Europe for just 30 million? I'm not so sure. I don't think that fee is accurate, and I'm really not sure whether or not Arsenal are definitely going to let him go. If they've got a brilliant, brilliant backup and a great plan ahead to replace him, just maybe. But even then, it's not like he's getting towards the end of his career that you're thinking, oh, we better take his 30 million now because, you know, he's not going to be worth much in a few years. If they get him back from injury and he goes on to prove what he can do and maybe fulfill some of that early potential when they signed him from Barcelona, there's no reason why he couldn't be worth way more than 30 million. This one I can't necessarily see happening from Arsenal's side, but yeah, from PSG. We spoke about it before. He's another one of these guys who'd go into PSG. He's probably better than most of the French league. He'd help them win another Ligue 1 title, but he's not going to carry them to Champions League. No, not carry them. He's not going to be part of like an unbelievable Champions League side. So next up, and today, all the Premier League shareholders and clubs are going into a big, big meeting for the future of the Premier League. Well, certainly for the project restart. So provisionally, the Premier League is going to be back on the 17th of June. Aston Villa against Sheffield United, I believe, will be the first game, followed by Manchester City against Arsenal later on in the evening. This is the midweek fixtures of the teams who still have one more game to play over the other sides in the league. Of course, a few days later on the weekend is when the whole league will start properly again. Now, one player, and from Tottenham as well, has tested positive for the coronavirus, so that's thrown a few doubts still as we get close to the restart of the Premier League over whether or not they can go ahead fully. Throw this to the side, and there's also the talk of whether or not a few games are going to be played at neutral ground. Certainly Liverpool against Everton, where Liverpool could seal the title against, well, their cross-city rivals, not going to say their biggest rivals, that game could be played at a neutral venue. There's also the rules that FIFA have said VAR can be scrapped, although lots of Premier League clubs think that will ruin the competition because, well, it's been used for the majority of the season, so why would they scrap it now? On top of this, there's also talk that you can use five substitutes, and some clubs are saying that for the bigger, richer sides with a better quality of depth in their squad, this is unfair. Chelsea have come out and said that they want to use name nine substitutes and use five of them. There's so much to be discussed, and the outcome is going to go on for quite a few days at least. So next up, and a quick roundup of the rest of the day's transfer news you might have missed, and Rodrigo Fernandes, the Sporting Lisbon midfielder is apparently on his way to Wolves in a £10.9 million deal. AC Milan midfielder Ismael Benacer still is attracting interest from Manchester City, with Pep Guardiola really keen on the 23-year-old. Ousmane Dembele has rejected a potential loan move to Juventus, saying that he wants to stay and fight for his place in Barcelona. And lastly but not least, the first European Cup final to have taken place since the restart of football happened in Hungary last night. And although some of the fans in the stadium did not adhere to the social distancing rules, on the pitch, Budapest Honved, I think that's how you pronounce it, managed to win the cup final. So, how about that? Bringing you some news from around the world. So lastly but not least, because it's Thursday, we come to this week's Thursday favorites. This is where you guys let me know in the comment section anything you want me to talk about. My five favorite whatever in football. This one comes from Matt Burns, who said, Matt, who are your five favorite EPL super subs? This is a damn tough one. So, because it's my favorites, you can just pick whoever you want as long as they came on as a substitute. But there's also a few stats to back it up. The first one, Edin Dzeko. Always seemed like when he came on for Manchester City, he just managed to grab a goal and so many late goals as well. In fact, everyone remembers that Aguero goal that won them the title back in 2012. But 2 minutes before the 93rd minute winner or whatever it was, Dzeko got it back to 2-2 in like the 91st minute. He really, really did have some key goals. Next up, and Javier Hernandez. Actually, so many of his Manchester United appearances came from the bench and he always managed to do something. He, much like the next player I'm going to mention, was always like a plan B, always just something a little bit different. Someone who's going to sniff out if you need a goal and just stay in and around the box and find the back of the net. As well as this, he also did some crazy acrobatic goals, and yeah, I just think he was a really, really good super sub and definitely a great option for United to have. So talking about plan Bs off the bench, none of them suit them better than Olivier Giroud. Again, another brilliant super sub, but one of the highest scoring substitutes in Premier League history. Whether it's for Arsenal or for Chelsea, if you need something a bit different, a guy to pump the ball into the box to, Olivier Giroud is your guy. It makes not sense, because that's pretty harsh against Giroud, but it's pretty evident that throughout his career, whenever there's been a brilliant fit starting striker at Arsenal or Chelsea, they're the ones who've made the starting 11 and he's been on the bench. Anyway, he's made the most of it and carved out a phenomenal career for himself anyways. Number two, and it's actually the record holder in the Premier League for most goals as a substitute with 24 goals, Jermaine Defoe. Honestly, for those of you who managed to see Jermaine Defoe play, and even a few Rangers fans that are watching in the comments section, an unbelievable finisher. Honestly, one of my favourite to watch. The ball could just be dead. You'd think nothing was on, and with minimal backlift, Defoe gets a snapshot away and manages to find the back of the net. It's probably that he's played so long in the Premier League that he has that record, of course, but still, you don't just manage to make such an impact so regularly without being a quality player. And finally, number one, my favourite EPL subs of all time, even though one of the things he's known for wasn't in the Premier League, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. He pretty much started the craze of being a super sub and is the poster boy for all you super sub fans out there. Not only is there the 93rd minute winner in the 1999 Champions League final for Manchester United, I also believe he came off the bench against, I think, Nottingham Forest and scored like four goals, maybe five goals. He was just an incredible super sub, and again, someone that kind of relished that role. Like, if there were fitter strikers at the club, they'd play. But whenever he came on, he was ready. And yeah, he'll forever go down as a United legend, regardless of his managerial career, for that last-minute Champions League winning goal. So there you have it. That is all from me for today. Thanks so much for watching. Leave all your thoughts in the comment section down below. Click here or here to check out all of the other videos we've got going on One Football. But until next time, I will see you guys later.